everything we sell, you can put your hands on. That will allow blind people to shop and choose and make decisions. To be able to see our expanded low vision clinic, where friends from the UC Berkeley School of Optometry will be there. And you'll be able to see what we're the Media and Accessible Design Laboratory, the Mad Lab, where we make maps that you can touch and talk. We make all kinds of things in 3D. You'll see a lot of signage we've created, the latest CapCut stuff. We're a world leader on that, as Scott has said. So what are all these rooms for? We want to triple the number of students, and we call them students now, not clients. The number of students that the Lighthouse serves every week in the Bay Area, just in the Bay Area, 20 people become blind and need our services. That was much of the impetus to create the new Lighthouse for the Blind, in order that we can have multiple classes, multiple teachers, multiple events, and do it with style and finesse. So in addition to teaching, well, there's more. We know that we have a growing obligation to convene and to spark and to catalyze communities that are far beyond the blindness community. As Scott was talking about, the high-tech sector. Well, now our multi-purpose room will allow us to have events from up to 150 people gather in style, connect, network. We had an impromptu thing. We opened the doors. I think the cocktail hour probably helped. And 100 tech workers from our neighbors, from Uber, Twitter, and all those folks just stormed in. We love that. And we need them. We need to co-design with them the technology of the future. We need to talk to each other. We need not to be in silos. That's why the new Lighthouse for the Blind is smack dab in the middle, mid-market, the growing hub for all things tech. Lighthouse has had a long tradition, too, since 2011. Dr. Josh Mealy and I founded Lighthouse Labs. I want to salute you, Josh. Lighthouse Labs is a place where every month we gather the best and brightest blind folks, technologists, sighted folks, people from big tech, and we talk and have conversations like available nowhere else. You know, folks who come to us every day now, can you make this app work? How come this is broken? What about this device? We now have a place that we can dialogue, and we do think that is our destiny. You know, part of our destiny too, and part of our past has been to be disruptive. And let's look at a little disruptivity. The great physicist Richard Feynman said, science is the belief in the ignorance of experts. Let me riff a little bit about ignorance of experts. In 1888, one of our progenitors, Newell Perry, a young blind boy from the Central Valley, went to the California School for the Blind. Anybody here from California School for the Blind? He wanted to escape. He wanted to go to a straight high school in Berkeley. And the experts at that time said, it can't happen. No blind person ever went to a standard high school. He argued against the experts, and he graduated from Berkeley High School. In 1892, that same person, Bill Perry, said, I want to go to the University of California. And the expert said, why would you want to do that? If you get an education, you'll just be unhappy afterwards because you won't be able to find a job. That was the standard expert feeling in the 1890s. Newell Perry went to UC Berkeley, got his degree, went on and got a PhD in mathematics from Heidelberg and became a noted scholar in mathematics. And that was just the start of his career. Yeah. In 1938, probably one of the greatest experts on any Laboratory, the guy who was the head of the National Association for the Advancement of Science, for 8 years head of University of California. William Wilson Campbell was losing his vision. And as an expert, he chose to do the thing that was prevailing in the 1930s. He climbed to the top of a four-story building here in San Francisco and jumped and ended his life. That was not that long ago. And also here, let's get a little more recent. In the 1950s, as recently as that, students who came to school, California School for the Blind and others, went through their entire school background without the ability to use a white cane. The cane was considered disruptive, it could be dangerous. We've changed all that in the years past. In the 1960s, blind people were, the experts said, blind people could not enter the civil service. Categorically, the government argued against our ability to be civil servants. A key decision that was made by a blind person here changed that. We changed that together. Thank you. In 1977, the experts in health education and welfare, Joseph Califano, said, we don't know if we should regulate this new thing, this Rehab Act. It's going to be too complicated. It's going to be too difficult. And the disability community is not just blind, but all disabilities said, we won't stand for it. They marched and occupied a building two blocks ahead of me here, the old federal building. They occupied it until the Carter administration signed those regulations. Largest occupation in the history of the disability movement and of the United States. In 1984, a little outfit down in Cupertino had an idea, and they decided to come up with a computer that actually had a graphical user interface, the Macintosh. The experts said, this will never talk. This is the end of the way God intended computers with a command line interface. Within a very short time, people, mostly here in the Bay Area, got the Macintosh talking, and it's been talking ever since. In 2002, there was a proposal I was part of to have immersion retreats for seniors. These are old people who wanted to address their blindness. They'd leave their home. They'd learn Braille. They'd learn cooking. They'd spend time away. People said, they'd never do it. Seniors can't learn this blindness stuff. We started that in 2002, and throughout Northern California, senior retreats now, including the Lighthouse's retreat, have taught thousands of seniors the skills and proper attitudes about blindness. Yeah. In 2003, the experts at the San Mateo County of Child Protection Services heard about a couple who just delivered a newborn son. Nothing wrong with the son. Nothing wrong with the parents, except they were both blind. The expert said, we got to take the kid away from the parents. Thanks to the extended community and the American Council of the Blind, that decision was reversed. In 2007, the same little firm in Cupertino came out with a kind of phone that had no buttons. People said, this would be the end of telephony as we know it. They actually were right. Anybody got an iPhone now? In 2012, the folks at Coinstar, we asked at the Lighthouse, the folks at Coinstar, what about those 30,000 kiosks around that sell DVDs, red boxes? We can't use them. And they said that would be impossible. We can't make that talk. We can't put buttons on these things. We're just a poor $5 billion company. Well, we work with Redbox, and last week I'm proud to red box.
Woo!
$3,000 of which will be rolled out across California in the coming months. So today, the experts say that in the year 2020, a nice year, 10 million self-driving cars will be on the streets of the United States. 10 million. But the experts say, and the insurance people say, those cars will need a steering wheel and a licensed driver. What a heartbreaking end to technology. I have a feeling the Lighthouse will have something to do with making sure those things can be driven independently by blind people as well. Experts in the consumer electronics field say it's too hard to take all those touch screens that adorn our dishwashers and washing machines and stoves and disable, perfectly able blind people because of inattention. They say it's going to be too hard to retrofit or too hard to design for blind consumers. I have a feeling the Lighthouse is going to be doing something about that in our future. Must challenge these ideas. We must be optimistic. We believe in each other. In fact, it is what we do. We are the shared humanity. We believe in each other's ability to grow. I learned Braille at age 39. I'm giving you this speech from paper Braille hard copy. The folks that I learned it from, some of them didn't think that somebody as late as 39. I know that was only a year or two ago. Good learning from Braille, but here we are. So, in a half an hour or so, you're going to see the new Lighthouse. You're going to see the physical manifestation of the hope and love and aspiration of our community to soar higher, to demand more of ourselves and of the society in which we live.
Oh, yeah.
But if you want to see the real Lighthouse, I ask you, don't look at those beautiful acoustic things that Chris Downey and others designed. Don't look at the teaching sites and the playfulness and the warmth and welcoming. Instead, I invite you to look to your left and look to your right and see the people here who are compassionate and caring and innovative. These are the people who have been, who are, and will forever be the Lighthouse for the Blind. Thank you. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce a man who I first met in our old Lighthouse building. Yeah, he came back. Our assemblyman, David Chu, 17th Assembly District, has been working in Sacramento now for a number of years on things that affect many of us. How about affordable housing, just to start? So at this time, it's my honor and privilege to introduce member of the Assembly from the 17th District, David Chu. Can we first give it up for Brian, your CEO? For being warriors for our blind community. All of us can see or feel the sun today. I think the sun is shining on the Lighthouse today in San Francisco. I've been honored to represent you in the California State Assembly, but I have to tell you that it is more important to me that the Lighthouse is in the center of my Assembly district. There's so many reasons why we've all come.